How do you make the impossible to become possible? Is there any of you that is struggling with something for a very long time and you find it very difficult to overcome it? Tonight, I want the Holy Spirit to share with you, how to make what look very difficult. The things that are absolutely impossible for you to do or for another human being to do for you, become something that God will step in to do for you. You see, the Bible is called the book of impossible things becoming possible. If you look at from Genesis chapter 1, verse number 2, you go on all the way through the different sections of the Bible, whether it be the spiritual side, whether it be the historical side, whether it be the warfare side, one thing that you are going to encounter is that the Bible is the book of how the impossible became possible. Secondly, it is the businessman and the businesswoman's book of how to make profit. I don't know whether Lizzie is with me tonight or Berlin. I'm from Norway. If you're on the line, God bless you. Lee, God bless you. Mary of Pennsylvania, God bless you. Mary of Chicago, God bless you. You will sooner or later come to a major theme in the Bible, which is you are worshiping, that is worshiping God as God. You are honoring, that is God as your friend. You are yielding, that is God as your king. You're coming under his legal and divine authority. Sooner or later, you are going to come under a heavy impression that the Bible is a book of what was impossible becoming possible. And that is the most important thing God wants to impress on the tablet of your mind and inscribe in the deepest part of your spirit person, is that I am is the God that makes impossible things to become possible. If you do not believe two things about God, then you're wasting your time in following Jesus or the Holy Ghost or following the Father. Number one, he is the God that makes them possible to become possible. Number two, is the God that performs miracles. If you do not know these two things about God and you believe it like a fanatic, God will never have anything to do with you. Whatever you are doing is religious ceremony. And it's not going to work. Because you've removed God from his foundation, you've removed God from his title, you've removed God from what he does best, which is to do things that are absolutely impossible for humans to do for you and to perform miracles for you. If you remove these two things, then whatever you are doing is banza. Absolutely and incredibly rubbish, stupid, foolish, and idiocy of the highest form. There are many of you that God refuses to come into the existence of your life to do the impossible things because you are afraid of human beings. You are still afraid of everything. Therefore, it becomes impossible for God to be God because you are afraid of people. You are afraid of the creation and the creatures more than God. If you are born again and spirit-filled and you still believe that people can harm you, then God cannot be the God that does the impossible to become possible in your life. He will leave you to be in your fear and in your behavior. There are many of you, God refuses to enter into a vital relationship with you. You are saved. That's all right, but that is just where you are. You cannot go beyond being saved and your name being written in the book of life. But as for you having prosperity, as for you having protection, as for you having constant promotion, you cannot have it. And what is the reason? The reason is because you have belittled God. You are believing human being to save your life. Whatever you need, you go and start talking to people about it. And you and people begin to quarrel. You believe in another human being. And because of it, when they disappoint you, what happened? You run inside your cave and you do not want to talk to nobody. As though it is somebody else who is dictating your behavior. Your behavior is dictated by your five senses. Let me tell you, I live beyond my five senses. I have more than two eyes. I have more than four eyes. And I have more than six eyes. Every of our five senses is intensified in three different categories inside me. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. There are different dimensions of power and thrones and operation and dominion. I can change your world within 24 hours if you pay me. I can change your world within 24 hours. I can in fact devote a whole day for you and for your family. If you pay me, I'll do it. It's not free. One idiot called my ministry and was saying, why do you have to charge people for prayer? Do you go to doctors and not pay them? Do you go to counselors and not pay them? Do you go to your bank for them to keep your money without them charging you? Do you go to a lawyer to represent you in the court of law without him being paid big time? And I represent you before the court of law that is the highest in heaven and on earth. Why mustn't I be paid? The privilege of going to talk to the king. It's not everybody who allowed certain access like I am allowed. That's why a lot of foolish pastors go about talking about how the election is going to be. I wonder where they will be, where those pastors are going to be, because I am going to go public. Because I've given them chance. I gave them a chance when they said that Mitt Romney was going to be the next president. I gave them a chance for them to leave politics. They refused. In fact, one of them tonight, after this meeting, I'm going to remove my credit card from his ministry. Because he was somebody that I admire. But because he has decided to be greedy and to behave like the bullies out there, he is not entitled to my money. And I'm going to go public against them. I'm going to attack them seriously. I'm going to bite them seriously. And I'm going to pray to the God who sent me to the earth to to remove them, not just from ministry, but from the earth, because they are fooling people. It doesn't mean that because you are saved, your name is written in the book of life, or you have a ministry, or God has visited you once, that means that you go to heaven to go and hear the meeting. God does not invite everybody to the meeting of heaven. Some of us are invited. It's a privilege and an opportunity. And those who are not invited should keep, they should just do the shut up. Just follow the news. You will see that I said the news before the news happened. Last week, is it 15 people in the security of Republican administration have spoken. Today, 75 of them have spoken. Again. And all of them are saying what I've been saying all along. If you think that this election is going to be a game about getting angry, no, it's not. No, it's not. I've been saying it for the past 4 or 5 years. It's about a woman coming to the White House. And a woman is coming to the White House, whether we like it or not. It's not because she's the best, but the two parties we asked, God told me to tell them to present two cows. And he will choose one for the sacrifice. And he will cleanse one of them and use them to do his business in America. One party did not present a woman. Another party present a woman. You must know what the agenda of heaven is. You must know where heaven is going. Who is heaven choosing? Is heaven choosing a man? Is heaven choosing a woman? What do they want to do? Who do they want to experiment with? That's what we are talking about. When immediately Barack Obama was sworn in during his first tenure, immediately I was told, see that woman that ran with him? She's going to be the next president. There is a guy who should become somebody important in American politics, but he does not have enough balls to stand his ground. His name is Paul Ryan of Wisconsin. That's where I started my life in America. If only Republicans will stand on principles, God will rearrange things for them. But right now, many of them are going to run away from the person that they failed to confront. The monster you've created is coming back to visit you. This is no longer a game, because we are dealing with the God of the impossible. Who will ever say in human history that the Israelites will leave Egypt? But God told Abraham 400 years before, when he told him to bring sacrifices to the altar, he told him, bring this, bring that, and put on the altar. Cut this, cut that. This don't cut. He brought a sacrifice before God. And God began to tell him that his children are going to be slaves for 400 years in a foreign country. And it came to pass. Where they went to look for prosperity, where they went to look for food, where they went to look for protection, where they went to look for promotion, become the land that enslaved them. And many of you are like that. The marriages you went into, the job you went into, the family you're born into, become the place of the enslavement. It became the place of your destruction. And how do you get away from it? The place that supplied all the things you need, because there was a Joseph. And after Joseph was gone, it became the place of your enslavement. Those that used to bow down before you, now are your boss. How do you deal with it? For 400 years. God has raised me to set you free. God has raised Jesus in me. He has raised the Holy Ghost in me. He has sent angels to work with me for your freedom.
Hallelujah.
Moses was sent to an impossible situation. A people who knew warfare and magic than any group of people in world history are the Egyptians of Moses' time and Aaron's time. There was no nation under the earth that knew magic and witchcraft. In fact, ancient Egyptians of the time of Moses worshipped the Trinity of Satan. Baal was involved. Lucifer himself was involved. If you look at the different things they worship, they worship the cobra. I can see you, you cannot see me. And ancient Egypt has always been very tricky. Con artists in their practice. They are doing you harm. You can't even know who is harming you. Their witchcraft was big. Big time. They've never arisen a civilization that used witchcraft like ancient Egypt. And they worship Osiris, the goddess of the water, and all sorts of gods in the water. And not only that, to show you the power of their witchcraft, how far they went. You see all the pyramids in Egypt? It's all a dedication to hell, to the spirit of death. If you did not know that, know it. The pyramids you see in Egypt are as, in fact, it is speaking one language. A dedication to the world of hell, the world of death, and to the worship of the sun. The sun god. And people are like, yeah, the pyramid. Oh, the pyramid. Do you know what the pyramid stands for? Are you aware of what you are dealing with? And Moses was sent to such a people who worship all this. All these powers and forces and thrones and principalities. What the ancient Egyptians cannot do by word and by deed, they summon the forces of hell. Go and read the book of Exodus. You see it. People just read and just start, oh, these are just minor things. No. There were no minor things. They said, Moses, you are back from the land of Midian. Ha ha! What power do you come with? How dare you tell us to let your people go? Are you not supposed to be the son of the Pharaohs? Why do you change side? You are a saboteur. You are a spy, Moses. We hate you. And then he told them his route. Aha! We always knew that something was wrong with you. And all of them said, let's prove your power. And they all threw their magic sticks on the ground and they all turned to serpents, to cobras and pythons and all sorts of wild snake, poisonous snake. And Moses said, really? The God who sent me back to Egypt also armed me. I stand here tonight to tell you, if God has not yet armed you, do not take up matters that are greater than you are. Because many of you are toying with witchcraft, toying with prayers, toying with the Bible. You don't even know the power behind what you are doing. Many of you do not want to pay a price to get power. You are there complaining against what people are doing against you. You are not yet ready for me to equip you with power. Jesus told the disciples, stay in the upper room until I anoint you with the Holy Ghost and power that the Father anointed me before you go out there and challenge those powers. That's why many of you, your world is completely dabaru.
your world completely scattered. You're challenging your husband or your wife who knows more about hell and about Baal and about the world of the queen of the coast than you do. You're going to find your mother-in-law. You're going to find your in-laws empty-handed. You think that by saying you belong to Jesus, that is it. There is more to the fight. October 28 and 29, I'm inviting you, if you really want to see victory, come and join me in Wichita, Kansas. 2 days of battle prayers. Battle prayers. We are going to be praying for 2 days. That's what God told me. Tell them to come and pray if they want miracles. If they want to see the impossible, tell them to come and pray with you. Anybody who just want to come and sit there and watch, events will not come. If you are not coming to pray until the power fall on you, then don't come. Because many of us, we think that this is a joke. Somebody else should pay the price for us, and we simply, somebody should do the gardening for us. All we need to do is to go and wait for the person also to bring the harvest, and all we do is just get the harvest and go and enjoy. No. When it comes to certain things, when it comes to certain success, you are going to be involved. Moses said, "The Lord God who called me from being a shepherd to my father-in-law also equipped me. He told me that his power is in my hand. His power is in my shepherd staff. His presence goes with me." So he threw his shepherd staff on the ground. Bam! And he turned into the biggest snake that they've ever seen in their lifetime. And the magician of Egypt fled and stood afar away as they watched the snake of Moses turn into the biggest serpent they've ever seen and swallowed all of their own. And Moses grabbed that snake by the tail. And he turned back into a rod, and all of them like, "Whoa! You don't know the meaning of what I've just told you, and I will not tell you." Berlin, are you on this conference line tonight? She's not. Okay, I want you to remind me to do a teaching on the witchcraft of Egypt. The witchcraft of Egypt. Because you guys need to know it in detail. You need to know the meaning of somebody's staff, shepherd's rod, shepherd's stick, turning into a biggest serpent. You need to know the meaning. That was the beginning of the downfall of Egypt. Was when the shepherd's stick of Moses turned into the biggest serpent, biggest snake they've ever seen, and swallowed all of their own. Do you know the meaning of that? It means that until the power in you and the symbol of that power can enforce rulership, territorial power over people, nations, corporations, families, powers of darkness, so that you have them in your hand. When Moses' serpent swallowed the rest of the serpent, it means that from that day, Moses had the Egyptians in the palm of his hand. He now has territorial power. Berlin, remind me to incorporate what I've just said about the snake of Moses and the snake of the Egyptian, because I want to tell you in detail when you come to Wichita, Kansas this fall, October 28 and 29, Friday and Saturday, 2 days of prayers. Because I'm going to give your enemies into your hand. If I were you, I'll be shouting. I'm going to give your poverty into your hand to deal and to slay the head. Your serpent is going to swallow. Your serpent is going to swallow the different snakes. Snake of sickness, snake of poverty, snake of divorce, snake of bad luck, snake of the
bad luck people coming into your life all the time. Snake of instability, snake of doubt, snake of witches in your family and outside your families, and old friends trying to swallow you. The power of Jesus in you gonna rise up and swallow all of them, and you will have it in the palm of your hand. And you can say, old boy, how do you feel now? From that time, the magicians of Egypt knew that they were finished forever, and that there is no power, no god or goddess that they are going to consult that is going to deliver them from the power of Moses. They knew it from that day. And they began to plot how to kill Moses. I know that for a fact. But they knew that someone who can do what Moses has just done in their presence cannot be killed, because he has entered into the territory and into the circles of the gods. And you cannot touch somebody who is born by the powers of heaven and protected by such. Let me tell you, that day is gone when somebody will take your picture, when somebody will take your clothes, when somebody will take your pubic hair, your armpit hair, the hair on your head, some lock from your head, and go somewhere, when somebody will take your voice, recorded in a voice recorder, in an MP3, or your picture, and go to a witchcraft place, or go to the place of seances, or go to the place of the occult, or secret society, and present it and say, here it is. Or take your underwear, your bra, your panties, and say, here it is. Or take the secretion from the Jews, the lovely Jews that God has given to you, and go and present. And then they can just wink you and destroy you. Those days have passed. The days have passed that anybody who tries such a thing will die on the spot where they are about to present you. They now become when they were about to present you as the sacrifice for money or for anything, or to make their life longer, or to just kill you. While they are presenting you, death will be sent forcefully to come and take them. So they themselves become the sacrifice.
Amen.
Go and read Isaiah. I give people in exchange for your life. That's what God says. Which means, while somebody is planning to kill you, God will exchange your head for that person's head. Many of you, this thing looks strange because you were not born into this kind of Christianity. You tell me it's because you come from Africa. No, it's not because I come from Africa. Because there's a lot of mumu in Africa who don't even know what I'm talking about. There's a lot of idiot Christians who don't know what I'm, arrogant, crazy, ignorant Christians. They're out there. And they are the chicken for sacrifice, the cows for sacrifice. Those days are over. Go and read the Exodus. You'll see the story of how they left. Because many of you, when I talk about God killing people, you say, oh, this pastor, this prophet is too much. Nobody who is in his right mind will say such thing. This guy is crazy. It's not so. I'm simply telling you how God operates. Because when God will tell your enemies to leave you alone, they refuse. Leave this person alone, they refuse. Leave this person alone. And God has given them all the signs and wonders for them to back off. They continue. Then God has no option but to kill them. Just go and read the book of Exodus. After God has pleaded with Pharaoh, let my people go. He said no. He and his cabinet said no. We need these slaves for our profit. God said, okay, I'll show you. I've tried, but I'm going to show you. And God now sent an angel to go through Egypt in one night, killing every firstborn in every family and among animals. And when people woke up, their firstborn children were all dead. Then they knew that truly, 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 there is something happening. Moses wasn't joking. And they say, you guys can now go. Get away. Get away. Move quickly. And leave our country. We don't need you guys anymore. We profited from you guys enough. Go. Don't be afraid to tell God to eliminate people who want to eliminate you. Excuse me. Don't be afraid. If they refuse to obey divine signs and wonders to leave you alone, then God has no option but to eliminate them so that you'll be free. Because many of you have been taught that it's about mercy. Ask God to forgive them. Ask God to change them. But I want to also tell you, there are people who you can pray that prayer for, but also there are people who've sworn that except you are dead, they will never rest. So what do you do about that? If you go about, let me tell you, if God want to remove your enemies from your face and you go about praying for them, God will allow them to terminate your life. Let me repeat what I've just said. If you go about praying for your enemies who want to eliminate your life, then God will allow them to eliminate you and they will live and you will die. If you didn't know it, you need to know it now. Because it means you don't know how God operates. This is how to make the impossible to become possible. Signs and wonders. The display of supernatural power is going to be very important in making the impossible to go. How many of you knows how to talk to the moon? How many of you knows how to talk to the stars? The 10 billion stars in our planet and the 10 billion stars in 20 billion galaxies. Do you know how to talk to them? Do you know how to talk to the different sun and moon and stars in each galaxy? Do you know how to talk to them? Do you know how to talk to the water and the things inside the world of the water? Do you know how to talk to them? Do you know how to talk to the earth, the physical earth, and ask the earth to do what? Do you know how to penetrate into the minds of people and put thoughts into their head to do right? That's what we are talking about. There's somebody who has not called me for a while, for a couple of months. I didn't need to call the person. I simply focused on the person for 1 second and the phone rang and the person was calling me. Ha ha! Because my thoughts are things. My thoughts create things. Can you create things with your thoughts? Suddenly today, a song began to sing inside me and I began to sing the song. And I knew that God is giving me victory over something that I've been asking him for a while. Do you know how to use divine music to create things, to create success? It's all about power. It's not all about money. Because one problem can happen in your life and take all your wealth and money. Therefore, you need the power of God to protect your money and your wealth and your own life. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Do you know how to laugh at problems that comes your way? Instead of panicking, you start laughing. And that annoys Lucifer and his host. More than anything, because every problem he's sending to your life to make you sad, to make you cry, to make you crawl into a cave. And for some of you who take everything very hard, you take things too hard. Every little thing become a big thing for you. And when you are faced with big thing to deal with, you fickle out. Have you learned how to laugh at the impossible and said, my God is God of the impossible. He makes the impossible happen. My God is a God of power. I have a relationship with the God who made me. In fact, my very life is a miracle. How I become a human being is a miracle. It's a mystery. Why? Because I belong to the God of miracle. Since a human hand did not form me, therefore no human being can kill me. Belly, write that down. Since no human being formed me, since no human hand, don't forget to put hand. Don't forget to put hand. Berlin, don't forget to put hand. Since no human hand created me, therefore no human hand can remove me. Write it down. Since no human hand created me, therefore no human hand can remove me. Hallelujah. We are ministering tonight about how to make the impossible possible. You are wondering in your lifetime, at the age of 50 and 60, how can I buy a car? How will I get married? How will I ever have a house? Those are rubbish questions. Those are stupid questions. How am I ever going to start again if God asks me to have a divorce and move on and achieve my dreams? How will I ever do it? A woman had a consultation with me yesterday about, oh, she want to get back into a relationship, all of that. I told her straightforwardly, you can never get back into a relationship if your children are still in your home. The same children, who drive out every man that has come into your life. As long as they are in that house, it's not going to work. That's what I told her. Because your children come and go. When are they going? They are all from 30, 40s upward. When are they going to be on their own? Because there are children who never really want their mothers and fathers to be married. They want them to have a boyfriend, girlfriend. They are good with that. So that they can make money. They can pimp those men or those women who come into the life of their parent. They can pimp them and get enough money, but they don't want their parent to be married. They don't want it. Because they will lose making money. So how do you think God will hear you? So many of you are fasting and praying for God to give you a wife. For God to give you a husband, God will never give you any because you are not yet prepared. How many of your family members have you said goodbye to so that you can now focus on your own life? Many of you think that you are a Mother Christmas or a Father Christmas to everybody. See, God will only appear when you say goodbye to certain people. Then the impossible become possible in your life. You cannot tell me that God will make the impossible make you to become married when you have so many boyfriends or so many girlfriends and you are playing games. And you think that God will do that for you? Are you serious? If all you're looking for in a woman is somebody to help you financially, or in a man for somebody to help you financially, that's all you keep the person. Do you think that God is going to help you? How do you make the impossible to become possible? Many of you do not even believe in your talents. You don't even attach values to who you are. So anybody can push you aside and do anything with you and give you some money. I don't need some money. I need a lot of money. But many of you are wondering, what is he doing? Why doesn't he pick up his phone? If I put you to sit your butt right on this chair and sit down here and be answering all these phone calls, you run away. You cannot handle what I handle in a day. That's why I see many of you, you will call one line, then you want to call other line. I have marked those who are doing that. And I promise that I will never answer your phone call. Because if you're a member of the elite club, you are to call the 702. And if you are just a partner, call the 665. Many of you want to call my cell phone, then you call the elite club, then you call everything. I have marked those people and I have sworn I will not answer you when I see you doing that. Because it's an abuse. You are not subject to my authority and to my protocol. And it's not every day that you should be calling me. It's not every day you should be calling me. Because I need time to work. I need time to progress. One person cannot take care of me. Because there are some people who come into my life, they are very jealous, they want to protect me, they don't want others to contribute to my ministry and so on, they are very jealous over everything. No, one person cannot take care of a whole elephant. It's too much. What I need in life is big. Therefore, I need a lot of people to help me achieve my dreams, the dream that God has given to me. Therefore, don't come and block others. Because you have to be smart to know those who are coming to block others whom God wants to use to bless you. You need to know. You need to know when you've been married into the wrong family and move away very quickly. Many of you do not believe in the talent God has given to you. That as a nurse, as a lawyer, an attorney, as a judge, as an administrator, as an LPN, RN, nurse practitioner, nursing assistant, banker, all kind of stuff, that you are gifted. And all you need to do is ask the Holy Ghost, where? Please help me to find somewhere where I can progress, where I can succeed with my beauty, my handsomeness. I don't talk about handsomeness. I'm very pretty. I'm very beautiful anyway. I don't see anywhere in the Bible that it talks about that somebody is handsome. It's either you are beautiful or you are ugly. That's it. And I'm very beautiful. And I'm very sexy. And I know it. I mean, look at me. Look at me. Who would not like this? Look at how I look. Just look at me. Look. Don't you like what you see here? Look at me. I turn around for you to see. For those of you who are watching on Ustream, I am beautiful. And I have come to accept my talent. Some people are just so, they are trying to practice a holy living. They are kind of holy living. You don't need to brag about yourself. You don't need to talk about your talent. Get out of my way, please. Get out of my way before I give you a serious knock in the center of your head so that you see the Star Spangled Banner flying out of your head and eyes and ears and mouth. Jesus did not come and start telling people, yeah, you know that we have to take these things slow. You know that you don't need to really brag about who you are. You don't. No, he told them, listen, before Abraham was born, I've always been there. They say, seriously? He said, I and the Father is one. If you have seen God, you've seen me. I am, which means I am God. That's what he said. And let me tell you, until you can accept that you are a small God or goddess, you will not go anywhere. Until you can accept the fact that you were created to be a God, a small God representing the big God on the earth, you will go nowhere in life. You can succeed and have things and have some prosperity, and that is all you'll have. But when one storm comes, it will take everything away because you've not yet established your foundation that you were made to be a small God on the earth. If you doubt what I'm telling you, go and see. When the witch of Endor called the spirit of Samuel to come out, go and read. When she called the spirit of Samuel to come out of paradise, go and read what happened. She fell back. Saul fell back and asked her, what are you saying? He said, a God is coming out of the ground. Go and read your Bible. You see?
Some days I will start to teach about those sensitive areas of the Bible, which pastors do not want to go into. They don't want to become controversial. Until you become a God, you cannot exercise no influence. When I say God, I mean a small g, not a big g. And remember that you are not to be worshipped. Even though you are a small God, you are not to be worshipped. You are to be honored. It's only the God who revealed himself to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's the only God that should be worshipped. Only Jesus should be worshipped. Only the Holy Ghost should be worshipped. And that is it. I don't owe nobody any apology for this. Hallelujah. The impossible will become possible when you accept your position that you are a world dominion person. You were called to dominate the earth, and you will. Many of you believe that you'll never do it. You pass, you are now 40, it's over. And yet, the most important personalities on the earth were 75 years old when God appeared to him. How old was Moses when God sent him back to Egypt? Go and read. You thought he was a young man? Nowadays, if somebody is 40, 50s in America, you are thinking, God, you don't know anything. You are an old man. You go to many villages and places, they are no longer elderly people. Some hospitals, when you become older, they are begging you to donate your organs and die. And let them shoot you some heavy morphine for you to die. I worked in a hospital, I saw it all. I work in a major heart hospital and I saw the practices of medicine and what they do. So you better understand what I'm telling you. If you are going to live the life of possibility, heaven on earth, then you are going to accept your position. Because many of you have not yet accepted your position. That is why the impossible are not happening. And you believe your life is over. You've settled for government handout. You've settled for your children to take care of you. I don't have children for my children to take care of me. I don't need my children to take care of me. Till the day God calls me home, I don't need them to care for me. Why? Because I've chosen a lifestyle that is comfortable and everything is provided. And not just that I have human to walk with me, I have angels to take care of whatever I need. I lack nothing. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want, and I will never be in need. Because before any need arises, they bring it to me. And that's how you should be living. If you want possible things to happen, go and pray. Many of you don't believe in the power. I mean, prayer is not where the power is. Some of you talk about much prayer, much power, and all that crap. Prayer is in meditation. The power is in meditation. Prayer is an incorporation of all these things. Reading the word, meditating on the word, praying, dancing before the Lord, and waiting in quietness, not talking, until he appears. Staying in his presence. And not only that, when you declare before him that you yield to him, you submit to him, you are willing for him to lead the way. And not some of you finish praying, something happened, you are afraid. Where is your God? Where is your God? Let me tell each of you some of the assignments I'm sent to do on the earth. I'm to raise world-class leaders. That's my primary assignment. Number two, I'm to make women and men beautiful. That's my job. My job is to remind you of your beauty and to use it. My job is to remind you that you were called to be a small God on the earth and to be somebody that dominates the earth. Somebody that have prosperity. Many of you think that having wealth is a sin.
You don't really need a whole lot. You just need a little bit. No, I need a whole lot. God has a whole lot. If you don't believe that you need a whole lot, then the impossible will remain impossible. Do you believe that God can? Do you know that is the desire of God? Not believe. Do you know that it is the constitution of heaven for you to live a life of riches? I ask, Malia, are you on the line tonight? Malia, are you on the line tonight? Because she's not there. Lizzie is watching on Ustream, so I might not. I don't expect to hear her voice. I call many of you to look into hotels for my conferences in different states. And all of them were expensive. Almost all of them. Excuse me, please. Let me pick up something here. Almost all of them were expensive. And all I need to do was to get into prayer. And I said to the Holy Spirit, where do you want this? And I want you to confirm, back it up with favor. And when the people finally called me in Wichita, Kansas, favor showed up. Favor just showed up. Why? I believe that the impossible always become possible with God. Why? With God, all things are possible. That's what the Bible says. That's what I know. If you don't believe that the impossible will become possible, why are you following Jesus? Why are you wasting your time? Paquita, are you with me tonight? She's not there.
Yes, Bishop.
Paquita, are you there with me tonight?
Yes, Bishop, I'm here.
Okay. I want you to know, and I don't want you ever to complain in your lifetime about anything. Don't be impatient. There are things that I prayed about since 2007. I never received an answer until recently. Why? God wants to protect your interest, my interest. There are things he will not give to you because he doesn't want people to steal it from you because you are not capable of protecting it. You might think you are capable. You are not yet capable. God is putting the right people, the right angels in the right place, finding the right thing, making sure that it comes to you easy and freely and the best, and some of them free. And finally, when you will get that thing, you will respect it. You will honor it. Because anything God gives you, you don't honor it, or that thing doesn't honor you, it will go away from you. To be taken away. To be stolen. So that's why when I pray to God and I conclude amen and I wait when it doesn't come, and then I pray again the spirit of delay, then I pray again planetary spirit, and so on, and still nothing happened, then I know that there is a timetable. If I ask him, Father, what is the time for this? Jesus, what is the time for this to appear? And if he doesn't answer me, I leave it with him. I say, I leave it with you. I'm not going to be a disgrace. People will say it is you. You send me. You are the one who asked me to. If they ask me, why, I tell them, you guys ask Jesus. Hold him responsible. Hold the Holy Ghost responsible, not me. At the appropriate time, that thing comes of its own. You don't need to work for it. Many of you are asking God for a car. God is looking for somebody to talk to give you that car for free or to give you a house for free. God is looking for somebody to ask to put you in their will for big money. And he wants to train you first on how to handle big money. Can you handle big money? Can you manage big money? There are people who just want to spend money. They don't care about tomorrow. Good luck. Rich people are tight-fisted. They only spend money only at something that is necessary. If it's not necessary, they don't want it. Mary of Chicago will call me and say, you are going for a walk. Make sure that you don't sneak to eat somewhere because you have food in the house. I laugh, but I take it serious. Why? She's a good manager. Same thing with Liz, great manager. Same thing with Ladry. Those are great managers that I know of a fact they are. Ruby is the same way. Lee is the same way. Can go on and name those that I know who are good managers of their money. Paquita is the same way. I know her. I look at those sexy eyes and I know she is. Yep, I know it. You guys are like, how do you know her? Yes, I know her. Crucify me, I know who she is. Okay? Have you seen her? Yes, I have. Don't ask me how. Hallelujah. What about Lois? Yep, good manager. Because God will not allow impossible things to become possible when you are not a good manager of your resources. So God will stand back and watch and see the little that you have. Are you a good manager of it? So that he can pour the big thing into your life. Do you keep being a good mother to children who don't listen to you, who don't want to do their own part of the job in the house, and then they expect you to be a blessing to them? No, you can't do that. Life is a reward system. You want to do things your own way, then you are on your own. It's like when a young person discovers sex, they become arrogant. They think they've discovered heaven. Well, if you don't want to be in the house anymore, you don't want to be under my roof because you've discovered sex, you've discovered a boy or a girl, then you better go and start your own family. Because you're not bringing any pregnancy that was not planned into my life. Because everything is planned for me. If you are not going to allow order, law and order to be in your house, God is not coming to do to turn the impossible to become possible. If you are afraid that your children will no longer love you, if you tell them the truth of how things are, then God is not going to change the impossibles in your life. If you cannot look at your wife and tell her things that she must change, or your husband, then God is not going to come. Because many of us, we chicken out. And others treat us as though we are nothing. Those days are over. Many of you do not want to get involved in battles. Not just spiritual battle, but physical battles. Oh, you don't want to provoke nobody. You don't want nobody to attack you. What about those people complaining that you are the one attacking them? Let people talk that I'm the one attacking them, not them attacking me. I want to be the one who attacked them. While they don't see it coming, I take them on. And then when I run, the bomb is dropping from everywhere. While I am right there in prayer. If you want to know who I am, go and read Jeremiah 1, verse 9 and 10. It will tell you. Well, go and read the life of David. Berlin, am I lying?
No, Bishop, no.
Good. What did God tell you about me concerning David and Jeremiah? Because that's fascinating that he will be going to go and gossip me to you. You and God are crazy. Believe me, both of you. What did he tell you?
He's going to be a prophet of nations. He's going to be prophesying in many, many nations. And also, he's going to be a king that he has raised in this act.
I wish that those two men who spoke the word of heavenly prophecy upon my life, I wish they were listening to this. I will send this video to them so that they hear what you've just said. Because you are confirming things that they said in 2012. The ruler. The ruler is coming upon the earth. And you are going to co-rule with me. It's about time. How did that make you feel, Berlin? Did that make you feel special?
Of course, yes, Bishop.
You guys do not know what's happened between me and Berlin. Berlin and I, we've been married for so many years. Over the last 500 years, we've been married. We have many children. You guys don't know. I'm sorry. God called me Berlin's boss. See, even God understands hierarchy and authority. When God wants Berlin to talk to me, he said, go and tell your boss. See? You see, the things of heaven are not things that are secret. They are open things. For example, before I entered into the 40-day fasting, God has already told her what to tell me to get myself ready, blah, blah, blah. And he's on. And nothing that she tells me is a lie. Because she's the supernatural eagle for me. And I'm going to consecrate her into an eye. You guys don't know what I'm talking about. This is interesting. Berlin, you know what I'm talking about.
Yes, people.
Good. You're going to get it all for me. And you will share in it. I wish that I can tell you guys what I'm telling her, because I'm speaking in coded language. She understands. We call it coded language. See, coded language. There are deeper things. There are deeper things. Things that are beyond, beneath, powerful. Suddenly, favor begin to happen to me. Suddenly, boom, 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 boom. So I wish that Paquita was in my city when she was telling me that she's tired of waiting. I would take her up. I would take her shopping. I would take her, I would take her to the best restaurant, the best five-star hotel in my city or in whichever city that I see her. And I'm going to make her feast like a queen, where she is. And each of you the same way. Because when you are happy, that's when God comes through. When you are happy, God comes through. Ah! Let me tell you, your happiness makes Satan to run. Write that down, Berlin. Your happiness makes the devil to run. There is no greater power in heaven and on earth like joy power and happiness power. Berlin, write that down. There is no greater force on earth and in the heavenly like joy power and happiness power. Write that down. Sometimes people are looking for the Holy Ghost to touch them, for Edikai Mary to touch them. All I need to say is, Lord, I create joy in the life of this person, and bam, it comes upon you, and the healing begins without me doing anything else. All I need to do is release it. Father, I create a car for this person. I create this. I create a husband to come out of the shadow and come into the life of this person. Blah, 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 blah. And your happiness just come. Boom! How will you feel if the Range Rover you're asking for suddenly come tomorrow? Thank you, Jesus. You mean to tell me that you're not going to be happy? There are some people, they are crying, oh God, give me a husband, oh God, give me a wife, oh God, give me children, oh God, give me a Range Rover, give me a Cayenne Ferrari, oh God, give me this, oh God, give me that. Immediately they have it, 1 or 2 days, their happiness is gone, boom. They're looking for next. Oh, I want to get into college, I need a scholarship, and they give you all the scholarship in the world. You get into college for 1 month, 2 months, oh, I don't like this. You go, boom. How do you think God will make the impossible to become possible when your happiness and your joy is very little? And for many of you who are crying, God, I want a husband. God, I want a wife. God, I need children. God, I need a car. God, I need blah, blah, blah. God give you 2-3 days. You are just short term. Short term. It's over. You are looking for something new. You are tired of eating a Burger King. You now need McDonald's. You eat a little bit. Thank God America give you a whole lot of restaurant for you to eat from. There is somewhere here in Wichita, in the west side, in one particular shopping center, that shopping center is just for fast food. Papa John's, Burger King, McDonald's, Kentucky Fried, Pizza Hut. In one shopping center is just a shopping center for fast food. So you can eat from one dish, you go to the next. If you don't like this fry, you go and buy that fry. Oh my goodness. It's just a whole lot of names that I've never seen. Rib joint, everything, just in one place. You can eat until you bust in one place. And by the way, they have the Sedgwick County Park and the zoo. So you can feast and then you go and walk it out. You go and take a long walk. That will take you like 2 hours to cover or three to cover the park alone. If you go on their walking trail. This one is not like the restaurants of New Orleans, whereby at the back of the restaurant is a cemetery. So you go in, you eat. When you bust, they take you to the back and bury you. God have mercy. That's funny, but it's not funny.
Are you talking about Louisiana?
Larry! Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't know you were the line. Yeah, but the point is, I'm telling you, drop it like it's hot, drop it like it's hot, drop it like a bomb. Come on, come on, come on. Larry, call me after this conference. Call me after this conference. I need to have a time with you, man. I need you. Come on, come on, come on. I want us to plan tonight when I'm coming to visit you in New Orleans. I'm ready to fly out to New Orleans to be with you. I'm serious. Well, tell Erica.
I would love it.
Tell Erica. Yeah, when you get up this.
Man, I'm going to work on getting you right here in this great city.
Good. Yeah. I'm coming to come and rumble. It will be like a rumble. A rumble in the jungle. That's what it's going to be like. Yep. Yep. Everybody praise you about the food that you are a master craftsman of. My goodness, I have never seen a people that cook this great like the people of Louisiana. They are great people. The food is awesome. I can decide to live in Louisiana and just, in fact, God will do the impossible things, make them possible because simply I'm happy. 24 hours I'm eating and enjoying my life.
Man, you make me laugh so hard.
Yes.
Everything
yes.
Was better.
Yes.
Everything cooking with butter.
Oh yeah, butter. Oh yeah, I love butter. I cook with butter myself. I cook with butter. Yeah, I cook with non-salted butter. Yeah. I have not eaten jambalaya for a long time. I've not eaten what do they call that one that you use bread to dip into that yellow stuff? What do they call it?
No, but let me tell you, the best dish is crawfish egg
touffee. Oh my God. Crawfish with what?
Crawfish egg touffee.
Whoa! I can't wait to eat it. Why do you think that I will make the mistake of going to heaven? I'm already living in heaven by eating what you are saying. That's heaven right there.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah. Oh, my goodness. Tell Erica that I need...
That is number one.
Yep. Tell Erica that I need to have a conference with her tonight. Wherever she is, I'm getting her butt off that silly marriage. I'm getting her butt off. Yep. Yep. I cannot wait to see.
I will call you after this, after the conference.
Thank you. Wonderful, all wonderful, right. Beautiful brother of mine. Thank you very much.
Okay.
All right. Wow. People of God, this is amazing. This is amazing. You see, things like this, just a communication like this. Quality communication about things that add value to your life. Why? Because I value quality food. I value it. That's why God will give it to you if you value it. Or you value somebody like Larry, that is a creator of quality food in New Orleans, in Louisiana, or Erica. These are not food that will make you fat like a cow. I prayed to God when my daughters were born, my twin daughters were born. I prayed to God that I needed a car that is big enough for me to put all their play toys so that I can take them to the office, take them to the park, take them everywhere, wherever we go. Going to Disney World, Disneyland, going to the Kennedy Space Center, going to all, because my daughters were born in Florida. And I asked, because by then I used to drive a Chrysler LeBaron. That was my first car. I went and looked at different cars, put the money together, because I always buy my car cash. Don't make car payment. While I was thinking about that, I prayed about that. That's when I learned that God is the God of what is impossible becoming possible. I almost bought a new car and give and have two cars or give one away. Then suddenly my boss called me out of nowhere and said somebody drove to the job. A white man, an elderly white man, and his elderly wife. And they said, we are looking for that guy from Africa that works here, that is also a bishop, a pastor. We want to bless him with the car parked out there. And my boss looked out and saw this beautiful light green car, big car, Mercury Grand Marquis. Very nice. Say, really? You want him to have that? Yeah, they say yes. Say, God told us to come and give it to him. It's okay. So he thanked them. They gave him the title and everything. They changed it over. They did not even know my name. So they left the place of putting my name there blank. And when they were gone, before I left that evening, my boss called me and said, I want to see you in my office before I leave. So I went. I was a supervisor over this side of the department. And I was also the crisis interventionist for the women and their babies. He called me, he said, come upstairs. So I came upstairs. So he asked me, how is everything? I told you, everything is very wonderful. I'm making money for you guys through my outpatient clinical practice. Because you guys, I hope you should know that I'm a trained medical chaplain. And I have many units of clinical residency. So he said, all right, when are we going to go for our walk? I said, anytime. We're going to go and eat some Cuban sandwich too. He said, oh, that would be nice. So he asked me, did you eat your chocolate this morning and your banana? I said, oh, yeah, I did. You, what did we? I mean, we have fun. Then he said, I want you to look out that window and see there is a big car out there that has been donated to you by a family. I don't know who they are. Do you know these people? I said, no, I don't. Said, that's your car. Here's the key. Fill your name here. That's the title. Bye. Now I have two cars. So now I drove my car to the house. My house is like 5 minutes. And then I came back and now drove the new car to the house. By the time I reached, everybody were looking at me. What is going on? A free car? You are living in a free house? You have an additional 1,000 bucks that some group are giving to me. My job is already paying me. I mean, it's a ministry job. They're already paying me. But a church came behind my back and added $1,000 a month extra to my pay. Think about that. See, God wants to show up for you as the God of favor. Berlin, write that down for me and remind me to do a good teaching on that. God of favor. Allow him to be a God of favor for you. Because there are things you are still planning. He knows that you have kids. He knows that you have a wife. He knows you have a husband. He knows the struggles. Tell him, I believe that you are the God that makes impossible things to become possible. Then you are arousing his interest in you. Don't come there trying to complain about what you don't have. This come day to come and talk about his power. Lord, I saw your power at the Red Sea. I saw your power at the River Jordan. I saw your power with Samson. I saw your power with Moses. I saw your power with Abraham. This is an old man. You gave this old man and his wife a son, and you gave him 8 kids. I saw you turn a man who came from Syria to become a rich man, and his name is Abraham. I saw you make favor to happen to Joseph in spite of his predicament. I saw you turn a homeless guy that ran away from his brother, killing him, called Jacob. You turned him into a billionaire. I saw it, God. What you did for them, I know. You don't say, I believe. When you say, I believe, Satan might challenge you. You say, I know that what you did for them, you will do it for me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah. That's good.
Because you are not different from the time of old. You are still the Ancient of Days. The Ancient of Days that walk in their favor will walk in my favor.
That's right. If you did it for them, you committed to doing it.
Yes, he will. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh, my parents were not wealthy. They were constantly sick. They were this and that. God said, shut up. Don't recite that incantation. Don't recite that book of your family to me. Tell me what I as God can do. Provoke me. Talk about who I am. Talk about what I did.
Amen.
Talk about what I have done with Jesus. Talk about what I did through the Holy Ghost. Talk about what I did with Paul, with Andrew, with Peter, with Philip. Talk about what I did with David. Talk about what I did with Hannah. Talk about what I did with Samuel. Tell me who I am, then I will act on your behalf.
Hallelujah.
Write it down for me. Tell God who he is, and he will become that for you. Let me hear people shouting hallelujah all over the place. Tell God who he is, and he will become that for you.
Hallelujah.
That's
right.
Hallelujah. Remember, don't forget what I've just said. Don't forget. If you forget everything I've said tonight, remember this. When you tell God who he is, he will become what you say about him for you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You open the Red Sea for them, then he opened your Red Sea. You made the wind to blow through the land, and they had food. They had everything. The impossible happened to them in the desert. He began to do that. Your desert now turned to a fertile land, because that's what you're saying. You see, God is responding to what you are saying about him. Please write that down. God is responding to what you are saying about him. Many of you are talking about Satan, talking about demons, talking about witches, talking about your problem. I want you to begin to talk about God and what God is capable of doing for you, what he did for others. Lord, I saw you give somebody a Ferrari. I saw you give somebody this. I saw you give somebody a mansion. I saw you did this. I saw you gave somebody an uncommon idea. Because of that, I know you, that what you did for them will happen to me. Say, when you are speaking about, you see, that is why I don't play every gospel music. There are some people who are just playing gospel music about themselves. A lot of gospel music is commercial music. They are what we call banza music. Banza music. It means they are worthless. I listen to those music that talks about who he is, what he has done, what he is capable of doing. Those are the things that I listen to. If you start to sing, he has signed me with the cross. He has signed me with his blood. You got signing. Hey! Write that down. Write that down. God, my God, is a God who is a God of provision. Supernatural and natural provision will happen because I am with this God. And that provoked God. He said to the angel, pull it out. Let me tell you something. If you cannot afford the real gold, just begin to use the ordinary gold, even the gold plated, to provoke God to give you the real thing. Hey! Father, look at me. I am selling sale. I am selling sale. And God begin to say and say, yeah? This woman, these guys, he wanna be like us. What stop us? We can't stop this. We can't stop Larry anymore. We can't stop him anymore. He won gold. He won diamond. Let's give it to him.
Yeah.
And you are there and somebody bring you an envelope. You open it. And it is pure diamond of the highest quality. You tell the person, where did you steal this to come and put me in trouble? He said, I didn't steal it. God told me to go and give it to you. Somebody come and give you a very costly car. You say, why are you trying to make the police to come after me? Where did you steal this? He said, no, I did not steal it. I bought it. And God told me to give it to you. He has already given me two. You say, you have three. Are you serious? Say, yes. And somebody will come with a bag of Ghana Must Go. There is a bag. I don't like that name because I have too many families in Ghana. There is a bag that Nigerians call Ghana Must Go. It's an ordinary bag. People will load money. Many of you are looking for husband. Ask God to give you husband who during your birthday will load up a bag with money and put it on your bed and say, open it and enjoy. Go and spend the money. Go and spend. That is the time that you can spend money. You're just praying for God to make you married. Marriage to poor people, God forgive you. People who are coming to tell you stories about why they are broke. I don't want your story why you are broke. You better go and find the money and bring it to me. Coming to tell your wife why you cannot buy her 50 pair of pumps. 50 purses, 50 bags. Different colors of nail polish or whatever? Different colors. Beautiful. If you wear a wig, you have so many different styles. You have a lot of hair, different styles. Until you'll be competing with your daughters and with your sons in who is the youngest, who is the sweetest. You'll be dazzling. You'll be shining. Dazzling and shining. You'll be sparkling. You will be bling bling. You will be bling 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 all over the place. And that is how it is. Show me one angel who is not a bling bling angel. Berlin, write this down for me. Let me do a work on that. Invitation to bling bling. God is inviting you to bling bling. Bling!
Every time I turn around.
Please bling, bling, bling.
Every time I turn around, bling, bling.
Yep. I went somewhere with one of my partner. And the person said, I want them to measure your neck. I want them to measure your neck. And I said to him, Attorney, wait. Here in Wichita. I said, Attorney, why? He said, well, there was one of the jewelries you were wearing. I thought that it was a little bit longer than your neck. I said, oh, yeah. I remember that. He said, let us go to the mall. He came, he picked me up. We went to the mall, and then they put this thing around my neck, and they measure. They say, okay, well, your jewelry that you should wear is 20 inches. Small size, it's 20 inches. See, that's why all of my jewelries, he began changing them right on the spot. He said, I want you to look nice, beautiful. You never see that attorney without a beautiful gold chain around his neck. Never. Beautiful bracelet. And he's an older man. Older gentleman. God wants you to bling. Don't leave the pimps and the drug dealers to be the blings. Or the hip-hop artist and the rap musician to be the one who bling. I want you to begin to bling. Bling! Wear the bling. Bling for me. Please bling for me. Bling for yourself. Bling for Jesus. Why are no good making young girl? God now my papa. Oh, Holy Ghost, my sinner brother, why I no go make it younger? Why will I not be proud? Why will I not show display? Why? God is my father. The Holy Ghost is my sinner brother. Why will I not enjoy life? Many of you were brought up in religion or churches where it is a sin to enjoy life. Say sin. You don't want to own nothing? Go and read Colossians chapter 1, verse 15 to 28, and you will see, even though God the Father has everything, he asks his son to create his own wealth. Do you know that the making of the heavens and the earth, them, all this planet, is Jesus creating his own wealth? Do you know that the making of a human being is God the Father assigning Jesus to create his own people? That's why I'm asking God to give me disciples. Tonight, I dare to ask you, if you want to be my disciples, let me know. Call me or email me and say, I want to be your disciple. And I will tell you what it involves. John the Baptist has a disciple. Peter has a disciple. Paul has a disciple. Jesus has his disciples. All of them have their disciples. And I must have mine. I need people that I can pour power into, life into, money into. I want to create things for people. Because I'm tired of broke people. Leona is a witness to that. I don't know whether she's on the line. No more broke people in my life. I want when people sow into my life, they give me a check, $10,000. They say, you go to Paris and shop. Go to New York and shop. Use this money and invest in the stock, and I will do it immediately. I've bought you 100 acres. Go and get people to come and farm for you. I'm ready. I love farming. As long as you can give me some donkeys, some sheep, some goats, some turkeys, I'm good to go. Some chicken, I'm good to go. Give me 2-3 months, I will explode the whole place. All those animals will be sexing like crazy and making babies for me all over the place. I'm serious. Yep. I will put the spirit of the bunnies on them, all of them. Yep. I'll put the spirit of bunny rabbits on all my animals, and they will be pumping out children for me everywhere. Ha! Hey, hey. Aha! Woo! They'll be making babies for me like guinea pigs everywhere. Me, boom. Early morning, I come, new baby is there. I come, give it a new name. Car, next one. Poo, poo, poo. Children everywhere. Geneva told me that she's going to help me. She told me that. I believe her. She said, bring it on. I'm going to help you. And then Leona came and said, I'm right here. She's serious. She's really serious. She told me a funny story a few days ago. I was laughing like heaven. Interesting. I know that I'm having relationship with the right people. Patsy made me a big promise. I've not forgotten. I have the right people. They are coming. They are coming. They are coming. Let them keep coming, Lord. Because we want to build a kingdom on the earth for him. I'm not trying to build a kingdom for my children like some pastors do. And after they are gone, the entire thing collapses. Even though their children are involved, the anointing that their father or their mother had is gone. I'm better than that. I've learned from those people. I've learned from their mistakes. Hallelujah. We are talking about how to make the impossible to become possible. Don't make your relationship with God to be labor-oriented, to be fear-oriented. Don't make your relationship with Jesus complicated. Keep it simple. Keep it simple. Don't let people put you through too many things that they themselves cannot do. Just to make a little bit of dollars from you, they make it complicated. You don't need no complication anymore. You've had enough complication in your life. You don't need anybody to put any more complication in your life. How do you make the impossible to become possible? Ask the Holy Spirit, plant me where I am going, where I will become successful. Plant me. There is a city that belongs to you in America or in the country where you are. You belong to a city where you are in charge. ask him to release you to that city and to release that city to you. Berlin, remind me to deal with geography and prosperity. Write it like that. Geography and prosperity. You belong to a city. Many of you, I'm praying for you in Texas, and your blessing is somewhere else. I was somewhere, and things didn't go well. After Wisconsin and Florida, Florida was just a place for me to wait. But I didn't know that it was just a waiting place. It was a labor room. I thought that I was coming to stay. Then God turned everything against me so that I can move. He actually sent somebody. The last name of the lady is Belle, who came to me to give me a prophecy. She's never seen me before, doesn't know me. She told me, you have to leave. I disobeyed. I stayed for a while. Then everything, God began to turn everything against me. Then I left. And then I went to two places where I thought they are good places, and everything did not work out fine. Then somebody invited me to Kansas. And from there, God asked me to move away. Then the prophecies, the anointing, the powers for ministry just came, bam. Don't do any other job. This is what you are called. If you try to do anything else, I will turn my face against you. That's why people don't understand when I ask them, pay me. It's because this is how I live. This is how I earn a living. And sometimes when you call me, I don't pick up the phone. I'm ministering to other people because that's how I earn a living. I have to be truthful to you about this. I'm not being paid by my church. They think I'm richer than they are. That's why I tell people who don't believe in blessing a prophet or a minister of the gospel, if you don't believe, then go to your pastor to go and solve your problem. If you have a church where you attend every Sunday or once in a while, the pastor in that place, if you pay your tithe and offering in that place, then the pastor of that church is the person who should take up your problem and solve it. And don't come to me to come and pray and minister to you for free. And you go and give your money to somebody else. We don't do it like that. God believes in sowing and reaping. And many of you don't understand this. There is what we call spiritual authority. God does not want a clash between me and your pastor. If your pastor can solve your problem, then stay there. If he cannot, if you come to me, then leave him. Leave that church. Stay with me. That's how this thing goes. You can't stay with two persons at the same time. Because there will be a clash of spirits. There will be confusion. That's why you cannot have two attorneys at the same time handling your case. There can be many attorneys, but they work in the same firm. They all are working in the same case. And then one of them will represent. If a doctor knows that you require a specialist, then he will send you to the specialist. And then after that, you bring the specialist who will report back to your primary doctor. That's how this thing works. There is also, many of you are making the impossible to remain impossible because you don't understand the rules of spiritual authority. You think you can just go to anybody and get anything you want? No. I do not listen to every pastor. I do not go to every conference. I don't. Why? I wasn't sent to go and be with them. You have to know how this thing works. It doesn't mean that because somebody is working miracle doing this, I'm sent to go and be with that person, or I'm to buy his book or her book, or to listen to their CDs. Or no, I don't. I don't need it. Because what they are teaching you or telling you is their own experience of God. I want my own experience of God. I don't need their own. Their own is not going to do me no good. Their prayers is not going to help me. It is my prayer that is relevant to God. In fact, it reaches a point that when you are in the deep places of prayer, that God requires your own song. He doesn't want any song from any other artist. He wants yours. Make up a song for God. That's the one he wants to listen to. Don't come to come and sing him a song that somebody else sang for God and played and everybody's by. God will require you to produce your own song right there. Make up one. I'm good at that. And when you start singing, along the way, words vanished and you are now making sound. And remember that sounds are greater than words, more powerful than words. That's why I am planning one of those years for us to have a soaking prayer conference where you come. All the prayer sessions will be in the nighttime from 7, and it will be done during winter. When the night come quicker, and everywhere will be filled with sweetness. Great aroma of jasmine and rose and lily and light, like all kind of smell. No electric light. What you have is candlelight, sparkling, flaming all over the place. And you can physically see angels. And people will enter into the place of sound. When I pray and I enter into sound, it's a different ballgame. If I'm praying for you, your problem has ended. Many of you think that prayer is something that I just enter and just pray and then walk away. It's simple. It's easy. No. Real prayers are not like that. There are some prayers that God will not show up. And I will stay there for 3 days. And some of you, you don't see me for one day. I didn't answer the phone. You begin to panic. I become your enemy. Go and read the life of Moses. He stayed in the mountain 3 days before God came for him. Some of us just want God just to come. Bam. When once we enter into fasting and prayer, God come. He doesn't come like that. You don't dictate how God come. God dictate how he come. Until you learn to be patient, to stay and wait, God is not going to do the impossible. He's not going to turn the impossible into possibility. Again, let your intelligence go when God tells you to let your intelligence go. If you plan to do something and God asks you even at the last minute to let it go, let it go. Because he's trying to prevent you from suffering and from pain. That's what he's trying to do. Trying to protect you from accident. That's why before I leave the house to travel, if I'm kneeling down by the couch in the living room to pray 2 hours before I leave and I do not see my domestic angel by the door waiting for me, I know that I have to just go. I do not need to fly. I need to stay away from traveling. When once I kneel and I begin to pray and I see my domestic angel standing there, ready to roll, carrying my luggage and ready to go. If you want the impossible to become possible in your life, you are going to listen to the inward witness of the Holy Ghost. Not just prophecy. Prophecy is one thing. The inner witness of the Holy Ghost is another thing. Lift up your hand wherever you are and begin to ask God and say, Father, I'm willing that the impossible become possible in my life.
Father.
Unmute your phone and begin to pray with all your heart and say, Lord, I want the impossible to become possible. I am willing to accept your ways of doing things. Good. There is somebody tonight that the Lord is healing you of a liver problem. I think I have to end this here so that I can restart this very quickly. I need to...